Lighting is a crucial aspect of creating visually stunning and immersive environments in Unity. I will be exploring the essential concepts, techniques, and tips to help you start your journey in mastering lighting in Unity. Now, in order to simulate lighting, Unity has to simulate real life, and how we see light in real life, or see anything in real life, is simply light bouncing around and hitting objects and then hitting our eyes. And those light rays can do a few things. You can have direct lighting, in which light ray will just hit an object and bounce and hit us right in the eyes, and then indirect lighting, where it will bounce off few objects before hitting our eyes. Now, the way that Unity does this is it uses something called Realtime Global Illumination to simulate light hitting different surfaces. And a few key concepts in that are baked lighting, real-time lighting, and then mixed lighting, which is just a combination of both real-time and baked lighting. Now, real-time lighting is amazing because it works dynamically as the game's running. You can see here I am moving around a directional light as the game is going, and you can see the shadows are moving. But the drawback to that, it is super costly in terms of resources. So you should consider using real-time lighting when something dynamically is changing in your scene and use it sparingly. So think of using it for flashlights or changing conditions like a day and night cycle. Now, the other option that Unity uses that can save us a lot in terms of resources is baked lighting. And how baked lighting works is it pre-computes all the lighting information, and so when the game is running, it doesn't have to do any of those computations. But the only thing holding us back there is the objects have to be static. They can't move at all. Let's take this lantern, and then if we look at the spotlight, it is set to bake. And so if I go to lighting and bake it, which, don't worry, I am going to explain baking a little more in this video. But you can see now that it is calculating all the lights in the scene, and it is sending out rays and bouncing them around and simulating what would happen if this light was emitting rays of light. And when it's all done, it's going to generate a texture called a light map that it's going to lay over the entire scene to help simulate all the light bouncing around in the scene. And now that it's finished generating, you can see here it looks really, really nice. It's a lit up room, and it's reduced the cost of resources that this is using. But the only drawback here is we can't cast shadows from it. Now, the last option we have is mixed lighting. And mixed uses the best of both worlds. It bakes some things, but it also allows us to have dynamic shadows or some dynamic elements. Although it's not perfect, you see here, this one is mixed and it's already baked into the scene. When I move it, the light does change and move, and it is in real time, but you can see the shadow artifact from the baking. So it does have to stay in one place. But with those three things, the real-time lighting, baked lighting, and mixed lighting, we get to create some pretty nice looking scenes here. And now that we know the basics of global illumination, now we have to think about what are our light sources. And we have quite a few. We have directional light, point lights, spotlights, area lights, PDA lights, we have all the lights. So let's start off with directional light. So directional lights pretty much simulate the entire sun. So look at it, that is it. That is the directional light. If you want to create one from scratch, you just go over to lights and directional light, and that would create another directional light, but I don't want to. So I'm gonna delete that. And you can see here, it is in real-time mode and it can cast shadows. I already showed that it can do that in real time. We can also choose to put it in mixed or baked mode. And it really depends on what you're using this for. If it's not gonna change, if you're not gonna have a day-night cycle, consider baking it or putting it in mixed mode. And yeah, well, the summary is it is great for lighting outdoor scenes. It sends out parallel rays from its angle. So right there, that's where the sun is, and it's shooting them out infinitely across the entire scene. And one trick I would suggest you do, or play with at least, just to experiment with, is we can change the color of this. Let's say something, ooh, we could go red for something ominous. And you can see here, we can change the intensity of it, so make it brighter. And then the indirect multiplier is how much it would bounce off once we bake it. As always, if you want to save even more on resources, you can always turn shadows off, or maybe even turn them to hard, although that's gonna make them look a little chunky there. But you'll notice that I changed this to red, and it looks okay on the blocks, but it's not really matching the skybox. So let's fix that. Now, one thing we can do is create our own custom skybox material, and that'll allow us to play with it a little bit. So if I come over here, go to material, I'm just going to call this skybox red, and then we come up here to the shader and we need to change it to skybox and then procedural. Now, in order to get this new skybox on there, it's not on there yet, we have to go to window and then go into rendering and lighting and open up the lighting window, which I've dragged here. Make sure you're in the environments tab, and then we are going to replace this with that new skybox red material. Now, to get this to match up properly, I'm going to go back and click Inspector here. I'm going to make sure I'm selecting the skybox red, and we can adjust the skin tint and see, and we can make the sky a little more red to match it. And then we can also come here with ground color, and the ground color is just going to be this gray color on the horizon or under the horizon. And we can also just match that or even turn it kind of darker. And there's a few other options we can play here. We can increase the sun size. We can also change the convergence of it. We can also increase the atmosphere thickness. So if we get rid of a little atmosphere, you can see it's kind of making it darker. It's like we're looking out into space. And then we can also increase the exposure. So you should always consider playing with your own skybox material when you are changing your directional light. They kind of work hand in hand. Now, the next light I want to talk about is the point light. And point lights are omnidirectional lights that shoot out from every direction from its center. Now, you can see here I have a point light in this little thing right here. You can tell it's a point light. If we look here, it has the light component point, and it's set to real time. If you want to create your own, you can always go to light and then point light. And we can see here that I've created another point light, but it's outside the room. Let's see if we can get it in here. Okay, and so now I have the point light in the room, and you can see it is affecting things in real time, but it doesn't have anything emitting at the center. You have to have something that kind of looks like it's emitting. Now, point lights are really good for simulating light bulbs, lamps, candles, anything that you want to emphasize in the scene. So even if you don't have something that looks like it's emitting light, maybe you want an object here and you just want a random light to highlight it. Point lights also are able to cast shadows, and there's a few things I'll point out using this guy. Oop, here we go. And I'm going to drag him up, and then I'm going to go to the point light. You can see we can change the color of it. We can also change the intensity, and that'll make things brighter. The indirect multiplier, again, this would be for baking it, and so this would determine how much it's going to bounce off walls. We can also increase the range, which is just gonna make it a lot bigger or smaller. Oop, here we go, there we go, and you can see it brightens, or it's just a small little bit there. Let's see if we can, there we go. That's a better way to visualize it. And we can just increase the range, and you can see it expanding and contracting. And yeah, that is point lights. Great for lamps, shades, and if you want to save more on resources, always make it baked or possibly mixed, and then really determine if you need the shadows from it or not. And no shadows, hard shadows if you don't mind harsh edges, and soft shadows if you really want that high definition. Next up, let's talk about spotlights. And I have this little UFO over here for our spotlight. And if I select it, you can see if I expand this little sphere out, I have a spotlight on it. Again, all you have to do is right click, go into lighting, and you can make your very own spotlight. And we can see here a spotlight just acts as, well, a spotlight. These are great for flashlights, headlights, or, you know, vehicle headlights, or any kind of spotlight effect. You can also use it for just highlighting objects in the scene. They can be used for real time, mixed, or baked. And again, if you want to save those resources, always use mixed or baked. Obviously, for a flashlight, you'd probably want it dynamically moving, since it's constantly going to be moving and casting shadows on things. Well, we can change a few things here, like the shape of it, by increasing this, decreasing this. The color, as always, we can change it to red, and so it would highlight on the ground, but it's not quite reaching the ground, so let me increase the range there to go a little bit past it, and then increase the intensity so we can really see it. And yeah, it is still not showing up, so let me move it a little closer here, and yeah, there we go. We can see it now. And yeah, that is the spotlight. You know, it can look just like this UFO over here where I've put the spotlight. You can see I've adjusted how it looks here with the shape, which you can do like that. And these are actually two separate values on this slider, an inner and outer spot. I've changed the color. We can change it from baked to real time to mixed. And so it's just like the point light, except it is a cone that shoots out. Now, the last one is a bit of a funky one for a lot of people to grasp. It is the area light. Now, for the area light, I'm going to make things dramatic. I'm going to turn off this. For the skybox, I'm also just going to make sure everything is really cranked down here. We're gonna, not that. There we go, nice and dark. All right, so now we have this pitch black scene, and let's see what we can do with an area light. So I already have an area light over here. And area lights can either simulate a rectangular or a dish-shaped object. And it just kind of provides a very, very soft light, a very large soft light. So it's pretty good for indoor scenes or maybe light shining through a window, but you don't want to mess with the skybox and have all that going on with a directional light. The biggest hang up with this is the fact that it is actually, all baked. That is the only choice we get. It's baked only. There is no other option. We gotta bake this thing. So you can see here, I have it set to disc. It can be rectangular, and so it looked like that, and we can change the size of that. We can change the color, the light, the appearance, the intensity, indirect multiplier, so it would bounce off and have more contributing factors to when it bakes, and then the range of it. Since it is a baked light, we need to make sure the items that it's affecting are set to static, meaning they're not going to move. So, you know, we have this room object over here. We could select all those and just make sure they're set to static. And then we have the cubes over here. Make sure they're set to static. And then what else? We have the country building. Might as well be set to static. Yes, and its children. The saucer. Why not? That's not moving. And let's see what else. Make sure the plane is set to static. There we go. So let's bake this. So kicking things off, you might not already have this. If you go to scene, you might not have a light settings, and it'll ask you to make one before it allows you to bake a light. You could just click new here, and yeah, we'll just say new light settings, and that's the one I will use. And all you have to do is come over here. We're going to go to a progressive GPU. It's just a little quicker. And when it comes to baking, I do have a more in-depth tutorial that you can check out over here if you'd like, and I'll make sure to link it in the description below. When you are doing your first bakes, it is very nice to lower this light map resolution. Otherwise, you're going to be waiting a long time. And let's hit generate map and see what happens. Now, it has generated a light map, so if we went over to bake light maps, you can see this is what it's generated, and this is what it's laying over the entire scene. If we zoom in here, you can see it has these soft lights that are bouncing off the ground here and bouncing onto our cubes over here, reaching all around, and let's see if it hits the area that we expected. If we come up over here, you can see it is hitting this rectangular area perfectly fine, but then diffusing outwards. And that is your very basic baked map. Now, as a quick little bonus, one other thing that I want to mention that I was just thinking of is if we take a bunch of real-time lights, you'll notice something funny happens. So let me duplicate this and stretch this out, and you'll see it duplicated it just fine. Duplicate it, stretch it out, and duplicate it, and stretch it out, and you'll see it is no longer producing a light. And that is because Unity hates when you use too many real-time lights. It actually stops you from doing it. It just can't handle it. So if you come over to Window, and then Rendering, and then Light Explorer, you can actually see all the lights that you're using in the scene, and how many are set to real-time, and how many are set to baked. If I wanted to see if I could turn this on, I could turn this one off, unenable it, and you'll see it turns that one on because that is its limit of real-time lights it can handle. So this is just a fun little tool you can use to make sure you have all your lights organized and understand what is going on in your scene and adjust things all in one go. If you want to learn more about optimization, again, I have a good video on optimizing and baking your lights. I also have another video going over light probes, how to use that and what they do. And yeah, to summarize, just make sure you use as much bake lighting as you can, reduce your shadows if you can, and make sure to play around and explore with the colors, the skybox, directional lights, the whole thing. I'm really happy. It's 2024. I think this is going to be a great year for all of us. Thank you, as always, to my Patreon subscribers. Without you, I can't exist. So thank you, and happy 2024. I'll see you all in the next one. Bye-bye.